In this video, I wanted to take a couple of minutes and look at a feature called Guestshell. This is something that is available on Cisco's Catalyst 9000 series switches, some of the older 3800 series switches, as well as the new Catalyst 8000 routers, and even some of the ISR 4000s. In these newer platforms, Cisco's built something that they call application hosting. While we call the feature Guestshell, in reality, it's just the ability to run a lightweight native Linux container directly on top of a Catalyst device so that we can have access to a Linux shell and a Python interpreter right on our Catalyst series switch or router. This opens up a lot of possibilities for being able to run custom scripts and commands and help with troubleshooting by being able to run Python scripts directly on the box itself. So let's go ahead and just dive right into how do we get this running on our device. For the purpose of this video, I'll be using a Catalyst 8000V. This is a virtual router image that's offered by Cisco and easy to stand up in a lab, which is why I'm using it for today's video. So as you can see on the screen, I currently have the Catalyst 8000V command line up. The first thing that we'll do is a command show IOX. IOX is the underlying application hosting subsystems that allow us to run containers on top of our switch. Now, as we can see here, most of the services are showing that they're either not running or not supported on this device. So the first thing that we'll have to do is enable the IOX services to allow us to build our containers on top of this router. So we'll go config t, and we'll just type the command IOX. And now if we go back to check the status of those services, we can see now that we have the services that were previously listed as not running are now showing that they are in fact running. Next, we're going to walk through a little bit of pre-configuration that's going to be required for our Linux-based guest shell container to be able to communicate with the outside world. So first, we'll start with configuring a NAT policy. We'll create a standard access list, and we'll name it IOX_NAT, and the IP range that we'll be using for our container is 192.168.100.0. Next, we'll enter our NAT statement, which is going to be IP NAT inside source list IOX_NAT interface gigabit ethernet 1 overload. This will allow our container to communicate with the outside world by NATing it to the gigabit ethernet 1 interface on our virtual router. Next, we'll go to that interface and mark it as the outside NAT interface with the command IP NAT outside. Now for the container side of things, we're actually going to create a virtual port group interface that'll be used for communication directly with the container. This interface will act as the upstream gateway from the container itself to be routed out our gigabit 1 interface. So we'll start with interface virtual port group 0. Then we'll add our IP address, which for this interface we'll use 192.168.100.1. Similarly, we'll do an IP NAT inside. Now that our NAT configuration is done, we'll have to specify some configuration for the container itself. So we'll begin by doing app-hosting, app ID, guest shell. Then we'll create a virtual network interface for our container and link that to the virtual port group 0. We'll do this using the command app-vnic gateway 0 virtual port group 0 guest interface 0. Under this config section, we'll also apply the IP configuration for our container by doing guest-IP address 192.168.100.5 netmask 255.255.255.0. We'll also specify a default gateway for the interface with the command app-default gateway 192.168.100.1, and that is out guest interface 0. And lastly, we want to set a DNS server, so we'll just use name server 0.8.8.8.8. Once we're done with all of that, we're ready to enable our guest shell container and start making use of it. So for this, we'll actually drop all the way down to normal exec mode. And first we'll do a show app-hosting list, and we'll see that right now we have no containers available or running. We'll automatically deploy and activate the guest shell container with the command guest shell enable, and this will take just a second to complete. In the background, this is loading the guest shell container, getting it ready for deployment, and then it'll spin it up and make it ready for us to use. And so we can see it was deployed, activated, and now it is running successfully. Again, we can check this using the show app hosting list command. And yep, we see that our guest shell app is running. Before we jump into our container, we can also see some additional details by doing show app-hosting detail app ID guest shell. The output of this command will show some additional detail on the container itself, For example, that it is an LXC Linux container, it is version 3.2, it'll also show what hardware resources we have reserved for this container, and if we scroll down just a little bit further, we can also see the current network config, and sure enough, it looks like the configuration that we specified was applied to our container successfully. One way to interact with our guest shell container is by using the guest shell run command. This will take whatever command we input and execute it on the guest shell, return it to our CLI without entering the container itself. So we'll do a guest shell run uname-a, and that'll output what you'd expect just as if you were running it on a Linux system. Now that's helpful if you just want to run one-off commands, but if you want to get access to the Linux shell itself, all you have to do is use the guest shell command. Now we see that we have a Linux shell, and we can perform the same uname-a command, and see that we get the exact same output that we did when we ran that from the Catalyst command line. We can also check that our networking config worked. Let's go ahead and try to ping 8.8.8.8. And sure enough, we do have internet access. Now for all intents and purposes, this is a live Linux system, so if we had an additional Linux package that we needed to install, or we just wanted to run updates, this currently runs CentOS, so we can use the yum package manager to update or install. For example, if I do a sudo yum update, this will go out and fetch new updates available for the system. I'll go ahead and hit Ctrl-C now, since I don't actually want to allow the updates to complete. The real fun comes in now, since we have access to a Python interpreter that's running on top of a Catalyst device. We have the ability to run all sorts of different scripts to help us with device management, troubleshooting, or even performance monitoring. For example, maybe we have an intermittent network issue that we need help troubleshooting, and we could write a script that on a given interval runs a couple of different troubleshooting commands, collects information, and then either logs that locally or sends an email out to someone. Or we might be able to write a Python script that does ping and page load testing to test performance from an edge device, where maybe we don't have a server or end client that's capable of running that. Also included within GuestShell is a Python module called CLI. This allows us to run both exec mode and configuration commands on the Catalyst CLI, which allows us to monitor and configure the device straight from our Python script itself. So let's take a look at this. We'll go ahead and enter the Python interpreter, and we'll import CLI. If we wanted to run an exec mode command, we would use the function cli.execute. So for example, in this case, we'll do a write mem and see if we can save the device configuration from Python. Pretty quickly, we get back a similar response that we would expect on a command line. On the opposite side, if we wanted to run a configuration command, let's say we wanted to configure a new interface, we can do that as well. First, I'll create an object that contains a multi-line comment that creates interface loopback 200 and then assigns an IP address to it. Now, while I use a multi-line comment for this, the function also supports using a Python list, so you could list out each command in order that it needs to be run. Now, in order to create that interface, we'll use the cli.configure function and pass that our config data variable that contains the commands we want to run. The helpful thing here is that for each individual line of commands that we've passed to it, we'll get a success or failure if the command was successfully able to execute. We can also make use of our normal validation methods by doing a cli.execute and passing the command show run interface loopback 200. Now, of course, I'm just having all of this output just dumped to the command line, but we could easily store this in a Python variable and parse through it to make sure that everything completed correctly and add in our own error checking and validation. So now that we're done here, I'll go ahead and quit the Python interpreter. Another thing that's good to know about is that, like before, when we could use the guest shell run command to run something within the Linux shell without leaving our Catalyst CLI, the reverse is also true. Within guest shell, we can use the do host command to execute something on the Catalyst CLI without having to leave our Linux shell. So for an example, we'll use the same write mem command from earlier, and we'll see that our device configuration has been saved. Now once we're done, we can go ahead and just exit out of the guest shell, and if we're done using our container for the time being, we can go ahead and use the guest shell disable command to stop the container for now, and we'll do a show app hosting list, and we see now that our container is no longer running, but instead it's in the state deployed. Now, if we were completely done and we never wanted to use the guest shell container again, we would use guest shell destroy. This command will completely remove the guest shell container that we just built, and we can again verify this by doing a show app hosting list, and we'll see that there are now no applications found. Okay, and that's it for this video. I hope that it was helpful, and thank you for watching.